how much I appreciate all of those who offered prayers on my behalf and all of those who checked on us and those who filled in the teaching and the preaching, did such a fine job. I especially appreciate the cards and the cards especially, even more than that, of the little folks. That's always a wonderful thing to see that kind of thing, and it's good that the parents and teachers are causing them to think about those things, and we just thank God and appreciate them so much for it, and all of you. We have a couple of visitors with us today. I think the last time they spent any time with us by themselves, they were about 7 or 8 years old. But they're Jody's sisters. They're twins, but not identical twins. But we're happy to have them with us. I'm especially glad that I get to preach to them. Not that they'll be that glad, but we're glad that they're here. And I assure you, they need it. But we're happy to have them, very much. John tells us in 1 John 5 and verse 19 that the whole world lieth in wickedness. Now that's not something that just surprises a Christian. Because a Christian, one who is of Christ, for so the word means, recognizes, or they wouldn't have become a Christian, that the whole world lies in wickedness. John talks about also earlier in that first epistle of John, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. For if any man loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. And then he describes what he means by loving the world. He talks about the lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, the pride of life, or the vainglory of life. And he makes it very clear, as does the whole of the Bible, that it is through the appetites of the flesh, unbridled by God's word, that sin entered the world. And death, of course, separation from God by sin. And 1 John 3:4 makes it also very clear that sin is the transgression of the law. Well, in today's society, although it has been such for a long time, it's just at greater extremes today, more acceptable. When it comes to morality of the Bible, it's just simply winked at. Fewer and fewer people pay any attention to it. They have their own way of measuring things. And if it doesn't pass their muster, then that's what's right or wrong. But the Bible is an objective standard. It's the revelation of God's mind to us, 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17. And God says, here's the way you're to live. You may not like it, may not suit your fancy, but it is the way that we are to live. When you read Jesus' simple statements in what we know as the Sermon on the Mount, he tells people plainly, if you're going to serve me, you will not be involved totally and completely in the affairs of this world to the exclusion of spiritual things. He says in Matthew 7, beginning verse 13, enter ye in at the straight gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and many there be that go in thereat. Now, what's the other way? Well, it's the easy way. It's the do-nothing way. It's the laid-back way. Some people might say it's the American way. Because straight is the gate, and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it. So that broad way is the broad way to destruction. It's broad. It's easy to enter in. After all, most of us like convenience, and we don't like to give up and sacrifice much of anything. Especially doing things the way we like to do them, seeing things the way we like to see them. When you look throughout the country, divorce is on every hand. People don't live together as husband and wife. They live together as if they were. Divorce is made easy through no-fault laws. Adultery is considered normal. Faithfulness to one's spouse is unrealistic. And when you look at Hollywood and the TV channels, then they try to make all these things normal. They make sex recreational. The political leaders don't like to look too much at things. And even a lot of folks who are pretty well upset over homosexuality sort of wink at heterosexual adultery because it's so commonplace. But it's not commonplace to God. It's not His will. And certainly those who wear the name Christian, as that term is defined and used in the Scriptures, dare not allow themselves to get caught up in any immorality. Let us keep in mind that to be immoral means that you accept a standard, but you don't live by that moral standard. To be amoral is there is no standard except you and what you want to do and don't want to do. And most Americans are in one or the other of those. Now, I know that there are still good people, and by good I define good the way the New Testament defines good, someone who loves the Lord and keeps His commandments. I know there are some of those. But the Lord's already said that the way to heaven is a straight way. Let me remind you that in the King James Version, straight is spelled two different ways. The way it's spelled in verse 13 in Matthew 7 is S-T-R-A-I-T. It's also spelled in modern English, only spelled this way because of its usage, is S-T-R-A-I-G-H-T, meaning a straight line. Well, the idea of straight is the Lord uses it here. That is, the way to heaven is straight, and few there be that enter in thereat, is that it's hemmed in on all sides by the authority of the Lord as set out in His Word. The commandments of God are given, and people can just not accidentally and nonchalantly enter into it and live their lives as it suits them. Only those who enter in the straight and narrow way are those who will submit to the commandments of God and walk therein. That's why that the King James translators rendered the Greek word S-T-R-A-I-T, because it is hard to enter in for the person who loves this present world. But you see, when a person becomes a Christian, they've learned to turn away from this present world. They've learned to look at things the other way. But just how hard can it be? Just what kind of trouble can follow the one who loves the Lord and keeps His commandments? Well, in Matthew chapter 10, Jesus made it very clear just how difficult that can be and what kind of sacrifices one must make and what to expect. Think not that I'm come to send peace on earth. I came not to send peace, but a sword. For I am come to set a man at variance against his father, and the daughter against her mother, and the daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. And a man's foes shall be they of his own household. He that loveth father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And he that loveth son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And he that taketh not his cross and followeth after me is not worthy of me. He that findeth his life shall lose it. And he that loseth his life for my sake shall find it. Question, do you really down deep in your heart believe that? The truth of the matter is a great many people say, I understand exactly what he says, and that's the reason I don't believe it. But Jesus is my Lord. He is my Savior, and oh, how we love Him. But Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments, John 14 and verse 15. And so it is that if we would face this world as godly people, then we must renounce immorality, and sexual immorality in particular. And by the preaching of the gospel of Christ, which is God's only power to save anybody, Romans 1:16, we call all men back to the truth of God in spiritual matters and in moral matters. I say this because in this world, the church itself suffers from all sorts of looseness when it comes to adultery, fornication. Over my 50-some-odd years being a preacher, knowing a lot of preachers, working in a lot of congregations, being here and there, pretty active in the church in Universal, that I've been exposed to I don't know how many people that bore a great reputation as being something in the church, and yet they were really immoral. And they committed immoral acts. We sometimes think, well, that just can't be so. But you add the internet to all of this and the pornography thereon, and it's even worse. And I stand here even, as it were, in my heart weeping, warning the brethren that don't be surprised when some who appear to be somewhat in the church are finally exposed to be caught up and eaten up and devoured by the devil, if from nothing else than pornography on the internet. When people learn that this world and those outside of Christ and non-Christians are unfriendly to the gospel, unfriendly to the spiritual body of Christ, the church, then we'd be better able to stand against these things. When the truth entered the world, the gospel truth, the New Testament system, 2,000 years ago, it entered the Roman world that was not a whole lot unlike our society. Divorce, immorality of every description, homosexuality of every kind, remarriage was rampant. God's law of marriage just wasn't respected. If you read some of the historians, they'll even talk about how the women measured their lives on the basis of which husband they were married to. You know, this happened when I was married to, let's see, husband number 4. Or this happened when I was married to husband number 6. It was that way. Now, how far are we from that today? How far are we? Be honest with yourself and God and ask, how far are we from that? And yet, when the gospel entered the world, it had the power to change people, if they would let it. And the early members of the church, the apostles and disciples, did not hesitate to confront the evil of the world face to face and let them know what was God's will and what wasn't. And they understood conversion, having heard and believed the gospel. They realized that meant a radical change from the heart out. And you can see it set out ever so plainly in the scriptures. Look with me to a few scriptures written to churches, and you can see how this was emphasized because they lived in the same society that we live in. And they went to work with the people like we go to work with and like we live around. And listen to what he said in 1 Corinthians chapter 6. Know ye not? This is written to Christians, folks. That the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Be not deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor effeminate, that's homosexuals, nor abusers of themselves with mankind, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners, shall inherit the kingdom of God. Now here's what the gospel did, though, in true conversion, in changing their thoughts and their lives. Verse 11, and such were some of you. Where's past tense? They've been converted. That's not the way it is with them now. When the gospel came to them, this is the way some of them were living. Now that's about as ungodly as you can get. But the power of the gospel to an honest and good heart can change people if they want to be changed. If they don't, they'll try to justify themselves and whoever else is in it, especially their own families. People have, it's just amazing to me at how people can say, well, I see wrong in your life, in your life, in your life. And they're right. They do see it. Well, when they look to their wife or their husband or their mama or their daddy or their children, they can't see it. And they attempt to justify it right and left. Such were some of you, but you're washed, but you're sanctified, but you're justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. Now that's to that one church in Greece and Corinth. But you can find the same thing when you look to Paul's writing to a number of churches in the area of Galatia. And he warns them about the kind of life that they must give up. They must not be a part of. In Galatians 5, verses 19 through 21, now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like. Now listen to him, of which I tell you before, as I have also told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Then he tells them what ought to be in their lives to replace these sins. You see, again, conversion. Here's the way they were without the gospel. They hear and understand the gospel and realize the change that must be made. And here's the lives they're now living, and the exhortation of the Word of God to encourage them to continue on. But if you turn over then to the next letter, to Ephesians chapter 5, verses 3 through 5, you'll see the same kind of admonition and teaching. And all these letters are written to members of the church. Listen, they've heard the gospel. They believed it. They've repented of their sins, confessed their faith in the Christ as the Son of God. They've been immersed in water by the authority of Christ into the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit for the remission of sins. They've done that. But they must continue to be faithful in the church of our Lord. So Paul says, verse 3 of Ephesians 5, but fornication and all uncleanness and covetousness. Now listen, let it not be once named among you as becometh saints. How dare we tolerate even one person who has been converted to Christ, falls back into sin, refuses to repent, and yet we turn a blind eye and a deaf ear to it. Does these verses sound like God does and that the Bible does? Neither filthiness nor foolish talking nor jesting, which are not convenient, but rather giving you thanks. Now watch verse 5. For this ye know, that no whoremonger, that comes from the Greek word for fornication, nor unclean person, nor covetous man, who is an idolater, hath any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. Now watch. Let no man deceive you with vain, which means pointless or worthless, words. For because of these things cometh the wrath of God upon the children of disobedience. Be not ye therefore partakers with them. Is that clear? Did he say what he meant? Did he mean what he said? Are these words from God's good word good for you and good for me? Of course, they are only if we follow them. A lot of people say, well, yeah, that's the Bible, the Word of God. It's wonderful. But let's get down to particulars. Not only in the case of immorality, but in matters of religion. Are we willing to change to fit God's pattern? The writer of Hebrews said in Hebrews 13:4, marriage is honorable among all, and the bed undefiled. King James says for whoremongers, American Standard says for fornicators and adulterers God will judge. Now it's interesting in the Greek language that the verb is not found in the Greek. And thus, it can be rendered in this way. Let marriage be held in honor among all, and let the marriage bed be undefiled. Now, let me remind you of this word, let. We don't realize the force of that. The Lord many times said that. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me, and so on. Let is a commandment, folks. That means you have willpower, and it's your will to submit to the will of God. That's the idea. That's the whole thing. Marriage should be honored by all. Marriage being honored by all means that the marriage bed is kept pure. Any sexual activity outside of a Matthew chapter 9, verse 19, verse 6, God joined marriage is sin. Fornication is any kind of illicit sexual intercourse outside of marriage that's done between someone other than husband and wife. From the Greek word pornos is where we get pornography. It is a general word for unlawful and immoral sexual relations. I say again, it includes any kind of sex outside of marriage, premarital, extramarital, which includes, of course, adultery or homosexuality and so on. But then you have the word adulterers. But whoremongers or fornicators and adulterers, God will judge. From the Greek word moikos, and it means to have unlawful intercourse with another wife, another's wife or husband. So Thayer in his Greek English lexicon says. You see, marriage is God's institution for man. Let me say that again. It's God's institution for the benefit and good of man. Man can't just take it and do it as he pleases. You have no fault divorce in America today. Well, that's civil law. But the Bible's clear that when civil law goes contrary to God's law, we ought to obey God rather than man. So it makes me a little difference how many courts rule that so-and-so's divorced, unless one of the parties in a divorce committed fornication, and the one innocent of fornication is putting that party guilty of fornication away for that fornication, that marriage isn't ended. I don't care how many judges say otherwise. So people go ahead and marry again. I use that rather loosely, because God only joins together, Matthew 19, verse 6, those who are eligible for marriage. If you're not eligible for marriage, you can stand before any preacher we want to, or judges, or ship captains, or justices of the priest. You can have 40 marriage licenses. God's not going to join you together. You must be eligible to be married. Now, who's eligible for a Matthew 19, verse 6 marriage? Who is? Who's authorized to marry? Anybody that wants to? No. Our world doesn't see that. Worldly churches try to say, well, you know, let's don't get into investigating their background. If they say they're married, just, you know, don't tell it one way or the other. Well, who's eligible for marriage? First of all, a person that's never been married is eligible to marry. Second of all, a widow or a widower may marry someone who's eligible for marriage. And thirdly, the innocent party in a divorce, where the innocent spouse put away the spouse guilty fornication. Folks, those are only three people God's going to join together, classes of people in marriage. All else is adultery. All else is condemned. Now, let me remind you, what did Jesus say? Straight is the gate, and narrow is the way that leadeth unto life. And few there be that find it. Because wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leadeth into destruction, and many there be that go in there. I think the gate gets rather narrow here when it comes to the average American's idea of who has a right to marry, divorce, and remarry. But marriage, I remind you, was created by God back in the Garden of Eden. And in Matthew 19, Jesus says, in the New Testament age, it's going to be as it was, not under the law of Moses, not under patriarchy, but as it was created in the garden. One man for one woman for life. Now, when members of the church decide that they're bigger than God, more magnanimous than God, more gracious than God, then they may say, well, let's just smooth this over. But the Bible talks about the church being pure, and that a little leaven leaveneth the whole lump. And Paul said to the church at Corinth, purge out the old leaven. In other words, if you've got members who refuse to be taught, who refuse to listen, who are going to do things their way no matter what, who are engaged in sin, who won't repent, then you purge out the old leaven. Now let's see. What did Jesus say? Straight is the gate, and narrow is the way that leadeth into life. And what is that word? And few there be that find it. Well, just what does few mean in comparison to all those that live on this earth now, have lived, or possibly will live? The Bible doesn't leave us without help in that. Anybody ever hear the great flood of Genesis 6 and 7? Did anybody ever hear that Noah and his wife, his sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth, and each one of their wives? I think that adds up to 8 people out of the whole world were the only ones that were saved. Does that teach you anything? When you find Paul saying of the Old Testament scriptures, whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning, that we through patience and comfort of the scriptures might have hope. What do I learn from that? Well, if you can't figure that out, you're really not being honest with yourself or the simplicity of the words and what they mean. When you come down for more help, all that great host that left Egypt, because of sin, they wandered 40 years in the desert, and everybody that left Egypt, 20 years old and upwards, except Caleb and Joshua, died in the wilderness because of sin. Out of all those that left Egypt, hundreds of thousands, only Joshua and Caleb, of all those 20 years old and upward that left Egypt, were able to enter the promised land. Was that written for your learning and my learning? Does it tell us what Jesus meant when he says, "Straight is the gate, and narrow is the way that leadeth into life, and few there be that find it"? We're not here to do as we please. Ken has referred many times, we all have in our classes, how that we are bond slaves to Christ by our own choice. When Paul wrote to the church at Rome, reminding them of what they did when they became Christians and what that meant in their life after they were Christians, he said that, "But God be thanked that you were the servants of sin, but you've obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine that was delivered to you. Being then made free from sin, ye became the servants of righteousness." Romans 6, 17, and 18. Now, if you go back earlier in the chapter, you'll see that he's reminding them of just what they did in becoming Christians and the exact moment they were added to Christ. They became a Christian. Their sins were forgiven. Know ye not that so many of us, as were baptized to Christ, were buried in baptism with him? You're raised to walk in newness of life. You're not living the new life when you're back here in your sins. You're not entering the straight and narrow way that you find. You do that when you believe in Christ with all your heart. Repent of your sins. Confess your faith in Christ. And then you're baptized. Baptized, immersed in water by the authority of Christ for the remission of sins. And you're not a Christian if you haven't done that. I don't care how many sweet-smelling preachers tell you you are. I don't care how many man-made human creed books tell you are. You've got this, read it for yourself. Now let me ask you this. When's the last time you read your Bible? When's the last time? It's God's Word. Don't you want him to talk to you directly every day? Can you tell me what's in here? Or are you sitting in judgment on what you think is important? You ever notice how people do rule books? Human rule books. They go through, and the first thing starts happening, this is more important than this, and this is more important than that. You do it with rule books all the time. Oh, we don't pay much attention to that here, but we really are hard on this. You don't find God talking that way about his book. You don't have him saying over here, "Well, now, I'm really expecting you to come down hard on this, and you better be up on this, but over here, I don't pay too much attention to that. That won't be on the test." And we approach the Bible the same way. And yet Jesus says, "He that rejecteth me and receiveth not my words hath one that judgeth him. The words that I've spoken, the same shall judge him in the last day." John 12:48. Now you may not like those words, but they didn't change them, and they'll be there to face you on the day you stand before Christ to give an account of the deeds done in the body in your life. Life is too brief. It's too uncertain, and we're all but one heartbeat away from eternity. So why can't we realize what is said in Hebrews 9:27? "As it is appointed unto men once to die, but after this the judgment." Sometimes in talking to people to try to get them interested in Bible study and learn the way of righteousness, they'll respond by saying, well, we're all headed for the same place. You go to your church, I'll go to mine, we'll all get to heaven together, which the Bible nowhere teaches in any form or fashion or to any degree at all. Well, I don't like that. That's not the way I've been taught. That's not the way I believe. Change your belief to fit the pattern. So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God, Romans 10:17. If what you believe is according to the Bible, you can show me in the Bible where you find it. And if you can't find it in the Bible, you better give it up. And the world's not learning that. The world's not learning that at all. The Greek word krino is the word translated judgment. It means literally the act of condemning and decreeing or inflicting penalty on one. And that's the judgment. And that's what is said in Hebrews 13:4. Whoremongers or fornicators and adulterers, God will condemn. Now, when people in the church, and I'm going to close on this, decide whether it's sins of immorality or whatever other kind of transgression of God's law it is, that they're going to do that. Paul made it very clear in 1 Corinthians chapter 5 as to how the faithful are to treat someone who is in that way. And it means you're not even to eat with them or to company with them. Oh, let me remind you, what did Jesus say? Straight is the gate, and narrow is the way that leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it. And frankly, it gets too straight for some people right here, and they just don't like what they see. And after all, doesn't God love us? And he's so full of grace and mercy that in their minds, when they come before God in judgment, though they know they're not doing what they know their own Bible says, if they know it says anything, that some way they'll slip by. God, you're so loving. But God is just. You see, there's another side to God that doesn't get preached very much. And even the side that gets preached that God is love, they have a false concept of love. Love always leads a person to render obedience to God. It doesn't lead one to disobey God. But God is just, perfectly just. And his word is the standard of judgment. And we must, therefore, be willing to face the just God on the day of judgment. And if you haven't received his mercy and grace through belief and obedience to the gospel while you walk this earth, you're not going to receive another day of judgment. Only condemnation for those outside of Christ or for the member of the church who sinned and refused to repent. So when it sounds like, oh, well, this or oh, well, that, I didn't say straight is the gate and narrow is the way that leadeth into life, and few there be that find it. The one that was nailed to the cross of Christ, Christ himself, he's the one that said it. The Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world and who died on the cross for you and for me, he's the one that said it. He who we confess to be Lord, he's the one that said it. But that same Lord said, why call ye me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say? So why pretend you're a Christian when really you're of this world? How do you know you're of this world? Well, when you know the truth of God and you don't do it. If you're not of the world, what are you of? Now remember, we started out by noticing what John said in 1 John 5. A whole world lieth in wickedness. That's the reason Christ commissioned the gospel to be preached to every creature, because it's God's power to save, and the Lord's not slack concerning his promise, that is, his second coming. He's not slack. He keeps his promises. Peter said, but he's long-suffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Peter also tells us that the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, into which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat, and the earth also and the works that are therein shall be burned up. Now watch how he concludes this should help us. Seeing then that all these things shall be dissolved. Now listen, and you ask yourself this question. what manner of persons ought you to be? An all holy conversation. Conversation meaning your conduct and godliness. Here's how it should be. Verse 12. Looking for and hasting unto the coming of the day, wherein the heavens being on fire shall be dissolved, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. Now watch the faithful Christian. Nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for new heavens and new earth, wherein dwelleth righteousness. Wherefore, beloved, seeing that ye look for such things, be diligent that ye may be found of him in peace, without spot and blameless. Straight is the gate, and narrow is the way that leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it. I determined a long, long time ago, when I was a teenager, I was going to be one of those few. Anybody can. I know they can if I can. But it means divesting yourself of anything that comes between you and rendering obedience to God. It means keeping the church pure, as the Bible defines that pure. It means being prepared to leave this life anytime. And someday we will. The Lord doesn't come back first. And we don't know when that's going to be. So if you're not a Christian, we've studied this morning what one must do to become a Christian. And as a child of God, if you've sinned, you can repent of those sins. Confess them and pray God for forgiveness. And God's second law of pardon for the child of God who sins. God will forgive. We can all rise up as one under the authority of Prince Emmanuel, determined to bow the knee to Christ and no one else. Willing to divest ourselves of the nearest and dearest and the best there is in this world, that we might gain his blessings. People who don't understand that aren't even ready to become Christians. For straight is the gate, and narrow is the way that leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it. If you're subject to the invitation of Jesus Christ, our Lord and only Savior, we invite you to come while we stand and sing.